Welcome to today's webinar presented by the College Music Society, the third in our regular series for the 2020-2021 academic year. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to MC today's presentation by Dr. John Chong, entitled Tuning the Mind and Body of Musicians. Dr. John Chong serves as Medical Director of the Musicians Clinics of Canada, as adjunct professors in the Music and Health Research Collaboratory at the Faculty of Music, University of Toronto, and as professor in the Department of Family Medicine of the McMaster Faculty of Health Sciences. Prior studies included completion of the ARCT in piano performance at Canada's Royal Conservatory of Music and a degree in electrical engineering at the University of Toronto. As a student, he worked at the National Research Council's Electronic Music Laboratory in Ottawa. His interests eventually shifted to studies in the fields of medicine, clinical epidemiology and biostatistics, occupational health, public health and preventive medicine, acupuncture and psychotherapy at McMaster University. In his role as medical director since 1986, he has treated musicians with repetitive strain injuries, motor control problems, anxiety, depression, neuropathic pain, nerve entrapments and stress-related disorders. His clinical and research interest is regulation of the autonomic nervous system using neurobiofeedback techniques for the prevention of repetitive strain injuries, focal dystonia, chronic pain, depression, and substance use disorders. I see that we have more than 70 colleagues registered for this webinar from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. Today, I'm broadcasting from my basement office in Boone, North Carolina, and Dr. Chong is in Hamilton, Ontario. We are also recording this webinar for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. John, welcome to this CMS webinar.
Thank you very much, Bill, for that very kind introduction. I'd like to thank my committee, Gail, Linda, and the rest of the gang in CMS for allowing me to speak to you today. Let's share the screen, and I'll go to the beginning. And there we go. Good. So I'm here north of the border. Welcome to you all. And first, I'd like to start off introducing where I come from. I've had a long career with the Performing Arts Medicine Association. Right from the get-go, I want to honor Dr. Alice Branfenbrenner and Dr. Richard Letterman for starting this whole field back in Aspen in the 80s. And now it's grown into a worldwide organization, multidisciplinary. We have our journal, ArtsMed, Medical Problems for Performing Artists, and our website, artsmed.org. The field really started to boom in the 90s with the development of medical technology. And for some reason, playing the Italian Concerto Third Movement was fascinating in this particular slide. So you can see the dots glowing in the brain and the poor piano player playing away in the MRI scanner. What I'm going to talk to you today in fairly quick order is about the evidence connecting performance stress and the neurobiology of injury and illness. So this is the tuning concept of mind and body with the act of performing music. So you're in the business of education at the college level, but it starts way earlier than that. And we all have our heroes from early childhood, and then we spend all our time in the studios at home and at the conservatory and the universities, and somehow we get out to the stage. There are other factors called determinants of health. One of the big ones, PAMA got this data, which is kind of bleak. So if you're a musician trying to make it or a composer, you're doing pretty well at roughly $16,000 a day or a year. Obviously in COVID now, most of the musicians are just surviving on government subsidies. Here north of the border, I'm not sure about south of the border, but I'm watching CNN for some hopeful data coming forward. So how did this all begin up here in Canada? Well, first of all, we have the Canada Health Act, which is equivalent to your Obamacare, which has been, of course, controversial, and I won't kill too much time about that. But I was a very sleepy professor doing my research in the 80s, building my tenure portfolio like all of you professors. And I had one project request from the Organization of Canadian Symphony Musicians back in 86. And make a long story short, I started a little project and said, what are the problems that would come into a potential clinic, which they wanted. And we have this kind of crooked acronym called MADNESS, and it still sticks today. That's what I see from day to day: muscle fatigue, anxiety, depression, nerve entrapment, and stress syndromes. Now, the beauty north of the border on with Canadian healthcare is that we have universal accessibility, portability, and somehow the clinic is carrying on and during these turbulent times. Of course, we're facing cuts, government cuts, and healthcare is a provincial matter. So they've cut music education quite drastically. Arts funding has gone really down the tubes because of COVID. And of course, healthcare funding has always been controversial, as you very well know from day to day as we move forward into 2021. So way back when, in the 80s, this is the definition of playing-related musculoskeletal disorder: pain during and after playing, numbness, tingling, weakness, and loss of control. And that actually started in this year parts, but it came out of the definition of repetitive strain injury, which was a hot topic in occupational health in the 70s and 80s. And out of this definition, this overuse syndrome came forward. Was it misuse? And all the debates we had at high altitude in Aspen, the key phrase that came out for me was the use which is excessive for the individual affected. So that's hard to measure in a population, but certainly on a one-to-one basis, I'm now talking to you as the educators to say, what is that limit for my student as we're working on the Wanderer Fantasy? So moving forward, many years, this is the sort of benchmark a study put together by Bronwyn Ackerman out of University of Sydney, Australia. This is a big study of 400 symphony players across 8 orchestras, government funded by the Australian government. And the headlines are 84% lifetime prevalence of injury, and at any time, 50-50 chance of playing hurt. And the risk factors, rip through them here, is excessive muscle tension, long practice sessions, insufficient rest, poor posture, muscle fatigue, sudden increase in playing, repertoire scheduling, stress, lack of fitness, insufficient warm-up. And you look at that, well, that would be a good curriculum to put in the conservatory, which we did at the Royal Conservatory, thanks to the Dean's Initiative, Jim and Agnesen. But what does that have to do with medicine? This has a lot to do with pedagogy, which is why I'm talking to you today. These factors, these risk factors, are, once recognized, can be modified in the student-professor relationship. So what happens? I contemplate I would never make a living as a pianist and a composer, so I want to be a rock star. So somehow I wasn't cool enough. And now we have more data on if you decide to go into popular music. So if you want to be a blues jazz person, that's good for Christmas carols. But if you want to be real cool to be a hip hop player, you might not live very long. So this is a comparison of life expectancy, male and female, in pop musicians compared to the population normal. This is a study of 13,000 rock stars from the 50s up till a few years ago. So it's a big sample size. So therefore we can tease out cause of death by genre. You can see in the red highlighted areas, if you're a cool old jazz player in New Orleans, well, we've lost quite a few with COVID and they have pre-existing conditions. Now, if you hang out and be cool in the punk scene, you may not make it out of the parking lot. And of course, the whole issue of mental health and overdoses is well publicized. Here's a more recent study from the UK Musicians Union headlines. Musicians may be up to 3 times more likely to suffer from anxiety and depression compared to general rates. This, of course, is pre-COVID data. And the reasons, the qualitative data is poor working conditions, lack of recognition, of course, physical injury, and the issue of Me Too that has arisen. So you've heard a bit about the issues from our previous speakers this year in the CMS webinar series. And this has very much come to light, of course, in your work in the university situation. Now, of course, your students, some of whom will actually graduate and go into the business. This gives you an idea of what's going on. If you get a job in the Australian entertainment industry. The beauty of this big study, it's big, 3,000 workers. It includes the administrative as well as technical workers in the business. So not just the performers. So the headlines here, we do it because we love it, but there's a powerful negative culture within the industry. The descriptors are toxic, bruising, competitive, bullying, sexual assault, sexism, racism. Bill and I had a conversation about diversity and inclusion as a priority for CMS. Absolutely. So here's the connection. And not surprisingly, high levels of mental health problems and suicidality. Now let's break this open a bit. Sleep disorders, highly common and very problematic in this business. What are the mental health problems? High number of reported anxiety and depression, 10 times the general population for anxiety, and 5 times higher the general population for depression. And willingness to seek out mental health assistance, yes, but where are those resources? So that's what is very important to think about. Back in your faculties and connection with student health, which PAMA is really focused on. Suicidality, it literally never goes day to day that I worry about my patients, but I'm sure you're worried about some of your students who've got into trouble with more severe negative thinking that life on the other side of the grass would be better than this side. So this is quite shocking data, but not shocking on from my view in the clinic. So we lose kids just very suddenly, and the warning signs may be there, but obviously it's a medical emergency to get your student or colleague to help quickly. Substance use, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, no surprise, but these are some of the data, which again, this is Australian data. So the only comment I usually make is Australians may be more honest than Americans and Canadians, but a pretty shocking number of drinks per day, 11 to 19. I love my wine, I used to anyway, but I'm not in that league. Speed is in there, ecstasy is quite high, cocaine is the big one, and then mixing it all up with alcohol, and of course opioids and tranquilizers. So if you're an Elvis fan, what happened? If you're an Amy Winehouse fan, what happened? Michael Jackson, and the list goes on to Prince and Tom Petty, etc. And again, the call is you can recognize this. You probably, the teacher-student relationship is probably one of the most intimate and close, can be anyway, and you're the first line to recognize some of these issues as they declare themselves. Let's start with a quote, easy stuff, the ergonomics, that's the biomechanics. So here's a simple clarinet sitting on a thumb, that's obvious. You're going to get thumb pain if you're playing 6 hours a day. And these are some of the biomechanical factors we look at for playing related musculoskeletal disorder. Why are certain body parts at more risk? Well, that's the way you're built. So we're in tight muscles, squished nerves. You can see the red muscle in the supinator squishing the radial nerve. You might have problems down line. So that's the supinator syndrome. Carpal tunnel, we all are familiar with because we're all stuck typing away and on our video games and gadgets. That's a compression of the median nerve at the wrist. Not so common in the musician population, but probably more now since we're stuck on our computers day and night. This is the most common playing related and most troublesome, thoracic outlet syndrome, which is compression of the brachial plexus and neurovascular bundle high up in the neck and shoulders. So this is the connection of posture, alignment, tension, and then compression of vital nutrients to the upper extremity. Very difficult to diagnose unless you have a high suspicion clinically, not common in a sports clinic, but extremely common in the musician's clinic. Motor control issues. Of course, we just lost Leon Fleischer, and Gary Graffman are credited with starting this whole field when they approached Alice Brent from Brenner way back when in the early 80s with their focal dystonia. And we now call this Chow-Main syndrome. You can see the comparison of the brain north. Which has a nice firing pattern, and then it's smudged in the dystonic patient. In general, it's very important to rule out other sinister pathologies. So vocalists, don't hesitate to have a look at your cords. You may likely see some nodules, but you might rule out some other sinister issues. Hearing loss is not to be forgotten. So we've been, Marshall Chasen and I have been quite vocal, literally, about these issues. And a study just published includes dancers as well. That's what it looks like, a bombed out cochlea, which is the inner ear. We have dose response relationships for this, even though controversial, the 3 dB exchange rule. And again, now because of the NASM guidelines, initially you're implementing prevention strategies, and that follows forward with the musculoskeletal guidelines, as well as the mental health, psychological health guidelines recently. So your partners in crime, NASM, and CMS and PAMA have been working very closely. Now let's dive in, have some fun. So let's open up a musician brain on the left slide, and I guess a lawyer's brain on the right side. And you can see very structural differences in the arcuate fasciculus, which is the auditory motor tract. That's what we're training. That's what we use to play our musical instrument and sometimes do other things with it, like type or play golf. So on the left, you can see the thickness and the complexity of the arcuate fasciculus. And our poor lawyers out there looking at counting votes and things, whatever they're doing today, it's much different and tighter. I usually talk about accountants, but I think lawyers are the topic for today. Now, why do we do this? That's the fundamental question. I've always asked myself every day, why do I do this music stuff? Just because I love it? Correct. Am I addicted to it? Yes, I am. This is a study by Bob Zatori out of McGill, looking at the changes in dopamine and influence of music on those neural pathways, the dopamine pathways. So dopamine, as you know, is the pleasure reward hormone and neurotransmitter. You can see the lights flashing in the appropriate areas of reward. The anticipation phase, as I practice whatever Beethoven today, actually it's Tchaikovsky today, and then suddenly going, whoa, this is great, in the Waltz of the Flowers. So you can see these areas. So it's real. And so one of my teaching lines, if you try cocaine or get, you know, you love your Cabernet from Napa better, you're going to have a big competition with Beethoven, Tchaikovsky. So be careful. You might want to reserve this dopamine buzz for something you choose to be very special in your life. How are we wired? This is the homunculus, worked out by Wilder Penfield back in the 30s. A couple important laws which we know, use it or lose it. That's Wolf laws coming from orthopedics. We know that as musicians, fearing we never want to miss a day of practice. I'm not so sure about that. And then Donald Hebb became famous with the line, what fires together gets wired together. But if you look at that real estate, it's very important to look at the upper extremity and the head and face, because you know musicians use these body parts pretty heavily. So we're wired in terms of the homunculus very differently than say a golfer. And that's what we look like. So the big embouchure distribution and big mitts distributions. And pretty interesting stuff if you want to go during our quarantine to look up some of this. Now, one of my buds from Vancouver has been working with opioid addicts and looking at abuse, and what he's published in this classic is When the Body Says No, the Stress Disease Connection. He's pointing in one of the most outspoken physicians about the way we learn about medicine, which I'm sharing with you. So coming down to the bottom part, and this is what we all struggle with as artists, authentic self-expression is the key, including but not limited to artistic self-expression. So you can see this starts with our art, but goes out into the creative industry and also the pedagogical institution and all these things. Of course, we'll explode that in a moment. So what's all this stress stuff about? It's about the mind-body connection, and it's about stress hormone, and our friend is called cortisol. Now, what is cortisol? It's a hormone that comes from our adrenal glands, which sits on top of our kidneys, and somehow the brain communicates with our adrenals literally in 250 millisecond spurts. Not as good as 5G, which is coming, but maybe it is faster than that. Lots of research is ongoing. And where does this stress response come from? It comes from your history, your experience. And it deals with the psychophysiology of adversity. Could be childhood, could be educational, could be occupational, can be personal. So, these are the key authors, Bessel van der Kolk, amazing work, Rob Sapolsky out of Stanford, and of course, Gabor Mate. Another character who's published, devoted his life work to understanding this mind-body connection is Stephen Porges, and it's the polyvagal theory, so you can look at that. It seems to be the biological basis of many mindfulness interventions, which I know you guys are very interested in. My teaching point there is, actually gave this talk in Vegas at MTNA, what happens to the vagus stays in the vagus. Okay, so it's tracking everything mind-body, all the way through, and memorizing it and responding to our environment. So healthy social engagement, mobilizing for stressful times, but after a while you get worn down and the whole system starts collapsing. Complex slide, but very simple. What happens with chronic stress is there's an allostatic overload. That means the whole physiology gets stuck on a crisis situation. There is no off switch. So that's the key point. And it lacks boundaries. It goes up, up, and away, as the fifth dimension says. Normally, if you didn't have all this trauma, what goes up must come down. Blood, sweat, and tears. But because of the chronicity of it, you start to get this immune response, which affects many organ systems. Bottom line, 1 year of chronic stress equals 6 years of biological aging. That's Nobel Prize work from Elizabeth Blackburn from San Francisco. And you can now, cytokines are now famous because of the dreaded storm from COVID. Well, that's instigated by a virus. What we're talking about now is instigated by environment and in music, and specific music pedagogy. So who are my friends? The Three Stooges here. These are the glial cells. Not that happy when you get excitotoxicity from cortisol. So the middle guy does a lot of work memorizing. That's Mo. The Larry looking guy with fuzzy hair modulates the immune system. And the one you really don't want to fool with is the guy on the left, the bald guy, the curly guy, because that controls the myelin, which conducts electricity across the neuron, and neurodegenerative diseases like ALS and MS result. So there's Jackie Dupre disease right there. So this is a hot area of research, not just because of COVID, but because of the connection of the mind and body. So you can see in the top, one wrong note, oops, I die. Well, I get a stress response, I get an inflammatory reaction, and then sets forward this cascade related to perceived stress. Here's the, looks really complicated, but think of the pink area as your accelerator foot and the blue area as your brake foot. And that's how our brain sort of operates in terms of our neural pathways. So when it gets, you start going too fast, you get an anxiety response from the excitatory pathways. And if you chomp on the brakes too much, you're going to slow her down and life is pretty dull in the anhedonic state. So this is the way we navigate through existence, whether we're playing the Wanderer Fantasy or just watching CNN. What's the connection to the muscle system? Well, there are little sympathetic fibers or spindle cells in our muscles, which are connected to the autonomic nervous system. So if you perceive threat, you're going to get a sympathetic signal. And then, of course, muscle tension. This is the work of Richard Gewirtz out of San Diego. Over to Harvard, do the Three Stooges exist, or is just a delusion in my mind? Well, there they are glowing in the dark with patients with chronic pain compared to controls. Even the same group has got better imaging now, and now you can see the chow mein syndrome, the fried noodles, in various areas. In this case, the sensory motor cortex, also connected to the frontal lobes. And people with conditions called fibromyalgia, which is basically tight, painful muscles, you can see the lights flashing in the differential activation. Really cool study from UCLA. George Slavich took his psych students and put them through their stress test, which is sort of like a music audition, and paid them $20 to get a brain scan. And guess what? The anterior cingulate cortex, the hub of the mind, as well as the insula of the body maps, lit up with this completely simulated experiment. So I call it bad THC, the effects of targeted, humiliating criticism. Now that has been enshrined as policy now in the American Academy of Pediatrics. This is McMaster work from my colleague who's passed away, Dan Offord. Psychological maltreatment is as harmful as physical assault. There are the ingredients, the risk to your health in public health terms is the same as tobacco and asbestos. Just down the road at Western University, Ruth Lanius has taken kids exposed to parental verbal bullying and peer bullying, and did the differential studies with this functional magnetic imaging. Pretty amazing technology. You can see the differential red spots in all the different neural networks. So it does, I call this slide, these slides, tracks of my tears. So there you go. In all areas of the brain's complexities in their neural networks. Back to San Francisco, Liz Blackburn and Alyssa Apple looked at a very stressed out group of mothers with handicapped kids and measured their telomeres. What are those? Those are the protective caps of our chromosomes on the ends. And they isolated four qualities of stress in these mothers. And I call them the four Teletubbies: seeing red, rumination, threat to ego, and negative mind wandering. And that's where the shortening of the telomeres and cellular aging and death come from. The Moshe Ziff out of McGill, we're jumping all over the place here, and he's now looked at the epigenetics of stress and attachment. So on the left, you're seeing a happy monkey with safe and secure attachment, and unhappy monkey on the right who's been disconnected. So if you think about monkeys and your students, your attachment pattern with your student is critical, whether the student feels safe and secure in the pedagogical relationship versus not. You can extrapolate that to auditions or getting a job, or now what life is like in COVID, being isolated from your family at Christmas. come back home. This is our data from the Musicians Clinic. That's what we're doing during lockdown. Again, our volume is way down. We're doing everything virtually. So I said, well, maybe we should look at what we've been doing for all these years. Good idea. So this is a comparison of adverse childhood events, standard questionnaires, compared to the big population study of Vince Felitti out of San Diego. And guess what? Our patients, not surprisingly, have higher A scores. So, and 4+ is when you get into trouble, you can see on the right. So I guess that's what I've been seeing, and not just picking out symptoms or conditions like a normal doctor would, but trying to explore some of the risk factors beyond ergonomics and general environmental conditions. So it's for real. And also, how do these ACE scores explain what we see? So the variability in stress scores was the highest, and the questionnaires, depression, anxiety, stress, anxiety and sleep patterns, as well as pain intensity. Interesting, we'll look at that about not explaining their pain interference or depression scores. So there is an interesting area of further exploration. Now, what is this ACE stuff about? Well, what is an ACE? Well, it's experiencing violence, abuse, neglect, etc. Just read that down there. So that could explain why so-and-so might just cruise through the Chopin competition and just ace it, or fall apart in the first round and not have that resilience that you heard about in the first lecture this year. There could be some connection to me too in the second lecture. So I'm connecting the dots on what you've heard in the CMS webinars this year. And what does that have to do with medicine? It has everything to do with medicine. And we in medicine are really not very good, or haven't been taught to screen for this these issues. So you can see early death, and you probably now can think about some of your heroes and why they left us so early. You know, and then some of their colorful histories when they grew up. And now it's becoming much more public in terms of recognizing these issues. What do we see in the clinic? It's not just PRMD and anxiety and depression, but a wide range in the shared care of the artists in the healthcare system. The problem is we are siloed in the healthcare system, so you may end up in the neurology clinic with a head injury, or you may end up in an addiction clinic, you know, from a multitude of substance uses. But again, connecting the dots, what does that have to do with music pedagogy? A lot. So bottom line, my stage name is Professor Nim Chimpsky, by the way. So targeted humiliating criticism, bad THC, is highly connected to adverse cortisol events. So you can think about it that way in terms of the acronym. How do you protect yourself? Well, it's easier said than done to put on your headphones, noise canceling headphones, or now putting on your mask and your shield. And you know, basically we're full of PPE everywhere we go now. And so we do have to have PPE for both physical and psychological adversity. Is the summary. So in wrapping things up, what are the risk factors? Of course, change in teacher or instrument, intense preparation for performance, preparing new and difficult repertoire, and prolonged periods of performance without rest. And that was written up in the 80s. Nothing's changed. Prevention, nothing's changed. These are my 1986 slides, in case you're wondering. Rest breaks, stretching, exercise, ergonomics, and don't play through the pain. Pain is a good signal. It's telling you something needs attention. And so work on your awareness of what is happening, getting back to those risk factors. So what do we have? We have tools, which I've been working on in the clinic with some of my PAMA colleagues. It's the Artist Psychophysiology and Ergonomics Lab, based on monkey see, monkey do, which is mirror neurons. So we figure that we could be a little bit more efficient and effective in treatment if we could actually see what we're doing, not necessarily wrong or right, but this is the concept of biofeedback. And then we can target interventions to create resilience. What are the concepts? I wrote this up in American Music Teacher, I think. Alignment, breathing, coordination, ABCs. So posture, obviously, breathing is so, so critical. And of course, we want to refine our coordination so we don't hit wrong notes. Diet and exercises cannot be underemphasized. Focus on goals is what it's all about. So now, what are the tools we have? We're kind of limited now under COVID lockdown, but I'll show you a little bit of surface EMG. We have motion capture, of course, audio video feedback, which you can use pedagogically. Heart rate variability is very, very important. And there are apps you can and gadgets you can integrate into your teaching. Neurofeedback, we now have home gadgets, psychotherapy now, it's mindfulness-based stress reduction, is John Kabat-Zinn, very famous, CBT, and psychodynamic work can all be integrated. We've done a big review in the last year and compressed that into the 12-tone tune-up program. Experimentation's going on with brain direct current stimulation. Acupuncture has been around for thousands of years, very useful, and medications. We're working on, I call it more better and less toxic preparations. So there's our 12-tune tune-up targets, partly because of 12 steps. That's what insurance companies like. That's what governments like. And I'm an unemployed 12-tone composer. So it starts with awareness, anxiety, boundaries, cognition, control, depression, dependence, exercise, fatigue, focus, goals, and then you graduate. So you might get through and do the PAMA Essentials course in Performing Arts Medicine if you like it. Basically, we've looked at the evidence and prolonged exposure. Cognitive behavioral therapy has a long tradition. Of course, lots going on with the veterans population, and hopefully we can apply these and evaluate some of the interventions I've mentioned. Moving forward. So there's your neurofeedback rig on the left and then the EMG rig on the right. So it's pretty neat for an old electrical engineer. So here's a fellow who you might recognize, Garrick Olson, who meditates every day, does yoga every day, gets his massage once a week, enjoys life in San Francisco, and tours around, I guess not so much now with COVID. But this is Garrick at rest. So the muscles, left and right traps, and lines 1, 2, left and right forearms, extensors, and line 3 and 4. So beautiful posture, beautiful muscle relaxation, and I can tell you heart rate variability, awesome. Okay, one wrong note, you die. In The Pianist, Chopin Ballade, G minor, and away we go, bang. So look how clean and beautiful those muscle signals are. So that's the whole, what we've talked about, just firing. This is a total focus and amazing performance. So he's got the chops, but you know, I want you to think more about more than just his hand span. You know, he's a big boy as well, 6'4", but it's more than just physical dimensions. It's this tuning. So this is the gold standard that I strive for. And he does make wrong notes too in some of the samples. So what are we currently working on? Well, we're north of the border. You guys south of the border, a few states have flipped over to medical and recreational cannabis. It's coming on, but Canada's been quite a leader in different preparations. It's not like that funny guy on the right with a whole bag of joints. This is one of my heroes on the left. I sort of look like him. That's Shen Deng 5,000 years ago, which published in the Chinese medicine literature, the uses of cannabis. So it's coming out. And what is its effect on all the circuitry that I've reviewed, commonly known as in the clinic as monkey mind? So that's what we're working on currently. And to summarize, going right back into the 70s, the prevention of overuse is the control of use. So I want you to remember that. That's, you know, one of the, it's not over till it's over, but, you know, there are so many factors that are in play during your lessons, and if it all goes well on the stage, but it goes a little deeper than that. So hopefully I've given you enough information to think about, to take to your teaching studios, and also to think in your committee meetings how to take forward some of the evidence and apply them, as we have worked with NASM to bring forward the guidelines and for accreditation. But you are the pedagogues, as I understand through CMS, the movers and shakers in the music education world to start taking some of this to the practice studio, but also in your courses about health and wellness, and also at a policy level. So hopefully, no matter where you're advocating for improvement and prevention of these illness and injury conditions, hopefully I've delivered enough of it. So I guess we can take some questions, Bill. So come back online and I'll get rid of my screen. Thanks very much for your attention, by the way.
Thanks, John. Yeah, that was absolutely fantastic. So much in there for our colleagues to review. I'm imagining that lots of people will tune in to the recorded version of this that we'll have posted next week, because
I hope so.
You've got a lot of stuff packed in there. The implication is there's so many implications from your presentation that touches on many of the things that are some of our individual webinars have addressed, and kind of pulls them all together and connects them in ways that are a little bit daunting, I would say, because it's obvious. I think I gather that my big takeaway is that it's a student comes to you with a particular physical problem. That's not the only thing you deal with.
And right.
So there's so many underlying issues that must be unpacked. A lot of implications for our pedagogy courses as we're developing our DMA programs, especially. I think in colleagues who are watching from DMA programs, are we preparing the next generation of teachers really to have knowledge, experience, creative ways of addressing these kind of issues with their students? I wonder, do you know of programs that are incorporating this knowledge in their curriculum for preparation of teachers or preparation of students and musicians?
Well, unabashedly, I'll plug the Royal Conservatory, Glenn Gould School. So my golfing buddy, Jim and Agneson, famous two piano troupe, Agneson and Kinton, plug for those guys. But we started a performance awareness course. I think it's over 10 years ago. Both Jim and I have lost our hair trying to get it in place. It's been up and down, as many other centers have done, as you put courses in. Interesting faculty vary, they're in it, and they can see, and some have pursued their DMAs and research in it, and others just are literally running for the hills and saying, oh my God, I don't want to deal with it. Students are varied right across the spectrum. This is a waste of time. I want to practice, the ring, and I got a performance tomorrow. And others are totally into it. And some of the students, as well as my patients, have actually gone on to do DMAs and PhDs in this area. It's fantastic. Yeah. So that's at home. PAMA spectrum, right across Europe, Australia. There are places now in the States. Plug in for Jenny at Colburn if you're there. Johns Hopkins has got something going. And so because of the NASM push, I think, in time, things will start. We share back and forth. There's so much now online resources that, for example, CMS is putting out. You can really, really, if there's faculty who are already on board, which is, I think, what Gail and Linda are trying to put forward, and then take it home. And so, but you're going to get some pushback. My overall lining is sort of like my golf coaches and hockey coaches, you know, come on. If you're not getting a pushback, you're not pushing hard enough. Okay. So, you know, don't expect this to be an easy ride, but it's still so rewarding to see things change and try to catch things early before, you know, it saves lives. We've had suicides in the National Youth Orchestra. I've been working with them very closely since the 80s, and it's just like, how did this happen? You know, but that's sort of what we don't want to be going each night with lack of sleep, worrying about this. We want to catch it early. This is what preventive medicine is all about. We could have caught COVID a bit earlier, I think. It's the sort of topic of the day. How come we don't have a vaccine? Mm-hmm. It's the same public health way of thinking. So this is not anything new. It's just that it's a different discipline. So I'm talking to you, getting at some of the root causes about this stuff, which, you know, I just commend to CMS for taking the leadership role and with our partners in PAMA and ACSM, et cetera.
Yeah, great. Great. Thanks. We've actually got a question, a specific question says, can you discuss the science behind stage fright and teaching strategies for helping students with it? Thanks.
Okay, great. So go back to my ABC 1, 2, 3 stuff. So if you as a pedagogue and you have Johnny working on his Wanderer Fantasy, so it's more than just getting the right notes and all this, Johnny, you're sitting like Glenn Gould. Oh, that's not very good. Okay, how should I sit, Mr. Teacher? So you can do that. Johnny, you haven't breathed in, you know, 45 seconds. Oh, thank you, sir. Right? Geez, if you actually have good posture like Derek Olson and you actually breathe, here, let me put this HRV gizmo on you. Oh, how interesting. Geez, I can play it a lot easier and I'm not cramping up and hurting myself and ripping my right hand up. Now that's a, you know, visualization of me when I was 14, and you know, I tried to get all the right notes and beat Pellini in terms of speed, but it resulted in a catastrophic injury. So that's, I'm just taking it to the practical level. If you can see, so if you do some Alexander training, you can do some HRV breathing, you'll learn that in your mindfulness yoga course. And then, of course, you guys are masters of C, the coordination, et cetera. And then don't forget the diet and the exercise and focus. And then, you know, again, it's pretty controversial on the boundary issue, as Julie said in the last webinar. You know, what do we do with that? We just respect those boundaries. But we probably know if this kid's in trouble, there's lots beneath the surface. Behind the inflammation and the pain. That's why it's a shared care. That's why you need professionals in your institution, both physical health specialists as well as mental health specialists, to work as a team to be there. So that's what we're hoping for. It's a bit utopian.
So, John, stage fright, yeah, it sounds like what you're saying, stage fright is, or performance anxiety, however you describe it, is a symptom of underlying circumstances, just like carpal tunnel syndrome may also be. Yeah, okay, yeah. Very, very, very interesting. So it's you've got to treat more than just, you know, breathe deeply today. It's got to be much more systemic change.
So that's what this performance exposure, you know, so somebody comes in with an injury but also has horrific music performance anxiety. Well, that's what this prolonged exposure therapy is about. Mm-hmm. Now, behind that, so I call my form of PTSD, not veterans, I call it performance traumatic stress disorder. Mm-hmm. Then we segue to the Whiplash movie, and I can segue to, you know, you probably can just, you know, breathe a couple times and visualize, oh my God, you know, when I walked into Walter Hall and there was Leon Fleischer there yelling at this student about the opening of the G minor ballad, I can visualize that right now. Mm-hmm. And I can feel the tension and I can feel it as I play that. So for some reason, I'm probably not going to play it tonight, but you know, so the body remembers, right? Mm-hmm. So you can take that PTSD physiology and apply it to whatever scenario you want, and you've got it. you know, very much like in that movie, which became quite famous. So.
Yeah, great. Several other questions, and here this is about the jury system. I think the jury system in music is one of the sources of harmful stress for our students. Can you comment on that as well as describe alternatives for juries, possibilities that we can offer our schools and departments?
Yeah, I'll stick to as best I can my scope. All right, so so I have numerous cases of performance traumatic stress disorder from juries, competitions, auditions, and just fairly graphic stuff that happened during the process, but also after the process. So, and this is very subjective, all these juries. And so looking at a policy level, how does your institution, govern behavior of the jury committee? What happens when there's difficulty in votes and recounts and stuff, etc. So without belaboring the political theme, right? So this is takes time to tease out. You have to be careful about planting it, just like any clinician or anybody asking, but you sort of know it's lurking somewhere in the room, and it's important to rule it out. But eventually, if you just ask the question, they'll just tell you straight up, I got roasted at the Rostropovich, basically. Even though I won in Tokyo the next 2 weeks, and then, so-and-so tells me the whole thing was rigged anyway. It's like, just devastating. Just devastating to the...
And you remember the Rostropovich more than you do the Tokyo, right?
Yeah. And it's etched in your nervous system. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So I can actually take the patient into reenactment, trauma reenactment, and elicit that with the full biofeedback and say, okay, let's de-escalate this response now.
I'm curious, using Garrick Olson as an example, do you see reactions that he has when he say plays a wrong note?
Yeah.
Hits a clam. Does he have reactions that are, I would think perhaps his are less than others because he's done all of this work. Yeah. Have you documented that?
Yeah. So it's written up in Clavier Companion way back, cited in some of my piles of stuff. And yeah, he laughs. He's played the wrong Chopin etude. He says, yeah. I've been asked him, what do you fantasize about? I'm talking about a dangerous clinical question. Pianos. You're Canadian, that Yamaha prototype, I played in Quebec City. I'm thinking, what? That's what you dream about? Yeah. So he lives in that utopian state. Once in a while, the piano's really terrible, but that doesn't happen to Garrick. Sometimes airplanes, get detained from snowstorms. That's irritating. He doesn't practice that much. He says, I know the stuff. It's on any given day, he has a nap for his performance, he apologizes and he starts over and giggles. Delightful, just absolutely delightful.
I wish
I could be this radically accepting of my own incompetence at the piano, but not so easy. It depends how you are trained. So
right.
So if your teacher laughs and giggles and goes, "Oh, Johnny, that was okay, but you better go to medical school, not as good as Horowitz." It's okay, but it's all in the delivery of that targeted. It can be humiliating, but if it's humorous criticism, then maybe that's a little softer on your targeted student here, who you, of course, we all care about them, but we have to examine our techniques as coaches and pedagogues very, very deeply based on this evidence.
Yeah. Well, that's probably a good point to conclude this on. We could go for hours. It's obvious with this topic and the way it brings in so many aspects of musicians' health and performance and music making in general. But I think we have to close it out. So thanks so much, John, and to our listeners today. I hope you've enjoyed this College Music Society webinar. You found it professionally informative. In the next days, webinar attendees should receive email confirmation of your attendance. Please feel free to use the comment option in that email to provide feedback about this series and our format. I hope you will return for future webinars from the College Music Society, including our next Musicians Health webinar, which will be broadcast on Friday, January 8th with Dr. Pete Jutras, whose topic will be healthy progress in a pandemic. And now on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I want to thank Dr. John Chong for his presentation and all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for today and the upcoming weekend, and I will see you in 2021.
Great. Thanks, Bill.